Committee for Safety, meeting for April the 20th. With me here today is members of our administration that's helping us out today, along with our many citizen members that we're very happy to have joined us here today. First, I'd like to acknowledge that we're in Treaty One territory, the traditional lands of the Anishinaabe, Cree, and Dakota, as well as the birthplace of the Métis Nation and the heart of the Métis homeland. First up, can I have somebody move the minutes of the last meeting? Okay, Sarah, all in favor? Okay, motion's carried. All right. Next up, we have our reports. Verbal report from me, I guess, is the first step. So I don't think I have much to report. I'm trying to remember if I told you guys this, so I'm hoping I'm not boring you guys. But one of the things I did do is I put a motion forward that was seconded by the mayor to have the province cooperate with us in terms of some of the buildings that we are having hard to house people in and very vulnerable people. So I'm hoping that we'll get some traction with the province to help us deal with this issue. It is stemming from a lot of the issues we are seeing within the inner city in terms of addictions and mental health that really need some major supports. And we need wraparound supports in these buildings because we're not being able to keep them housed, right? And the housing isn't safe that they're living in. So working with the mayor, we're trying to get the province on board to kind of align what the city can do in terms of the garbage and other things to help mitigate the issues that we're seeing, as well as what the province can do in terms of these buildings that are now, what's happened is with the province getting out of the housing business, the social housing business, we're seeing more vulnerable people that are living in for-profit housing, and a lot of those landlords are not equipped to deal with the issues that are arising within those buildings, and it filters out into the community. So really just having more of an in-depth discussion with the province on what more we can do collaboratively kind of to help deal with the mental health and addictions issue. So that's kind of my biggest report. And then the other thing, I think I just had a meeting on Air Canada Park, which has also been kind of an issue in the community, and we're looking at redevelopment of it. But we're also, what was really nice about it is we did a lot of inclusion of the people that are in the park already, and how do we kind of redevelop the park, making sure that we're not excluding people out of it. So we're looking at options on how we can look at that space and how to make it a space that everyone can use, but also a place that people want to come and see downtown, right? So we're working on that. So that's my report. Questions? I see that there's a question, Narinder.
Yeah, hi. Thank you for that report, Cindy. My question is not on this report, but I read something in the news, which we have all heard, is the neighborhood watch, which is being started again. Can you throw some light on that? I thought that was one of our mandates, isn't it, some time ago?
Well, the neighborhood watch, I don't know if you can feel, I don't know if you know more than me, but they are revamping itself and trying to get more people engaged and become members. So I know that my community, for one, is trying to do it, but we're also trying to do it with a more of an intentional lens, making sure that we're not profiling and stuff, but having, you know, coming at it at a different approach about when we do see people in the community, how, and there's a need, how can we respond? How do we make sure there is eyes on the street to make sure people that maybe are there to do crime or something know that there's people around? So that's kind of, I know that we're looking at revamping that in many different communities, but I don't know, do you know anything about the actual, because I know that they are looking at kind of a rebrand and reboot to their neighborhood watch. Oh, and the police are here too, so maybe they may know. Yeah. So, okay. Do you know anything?
Because I don't know about the old iteration of it.
Okay,
it dissolving, but I was going to say there's new stuff.
I don't know. I believe there was a press announcement yesterday, so we'll try and take that out.
And then I don't know. I'm putting our new police member on the spot. Do you have anything to add on that?
Yeah, it depends how in depth you want to go. I was just at Maples Collegiate last night for we call it the relaunch, if you will, of the Neighborhood Watch program. And we've done a whole bunch of community forums specifically in regards to Neighborhood Watch over the last 2 months. it's basically Neighborhood Watch is run by the community and supported by the Winnipeg Police Service. We offer a variety of supports to the Neighborhood Watch program, like Neighborhood Watch 204 in the Maples. They actually are out on foot doing patrols and things of that nature, whereas other Neighborhood Watches will be five houses on a street and neighbors looking out for one another to make sure their garage doors are closed. It really varies from community to community. It's community driven and supported by us. We have 7 days a week coverage for Neighborhood Watch captains, meaning if they have questions or concerns in their community, they've got an officer they can reach out to, and we can maybe direct them to resources and things of that nature. Does that sort of answer what your question was, or?
Yes, it does. But is there any role for the Winnipeg Committee for Safety in this one?
I don't know is the short answer, but it's again, the Neighborhood Watch is run by the community. If let's say myself and you are neighbors and we have four other people on our street that want to start up a neighborhood watch, one of us would be the captain, and all that means is usually that person's responsible for communicating with anyone if there's anything to share or anything like that. To be honest, I haven't really thought a lot about a role for this committee, but they're all run so independently and so differently. I don't know how this committee would support a neighborhood watch program, because they're truly all uniquely different depending on the area and how many people are involved and kind of what their goals is. Because some are literally just use social media to communicate crime prevention tips with one another.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, and actually, Narinder, if you remember a couple of years back, we actually produced a kit for neighborhood watch groups. So if they do want to start one, you know, where to call, who to call, like the, we should actually maybe take a look and see, you know, if make sure the numbers are correct, because if the police maybe have something new, we should make sure the numbers are correct. But we do have kind of a template for them to start.
Right. Good idea. Thank you.
The old neighborhood watch from a few years ago, there was community offices set up in the communities that had a neighborhood watch. So it's not going back to that model, if I'm understanding correctly, Andy.
Yeah, no, like obviously they've kind of centralized us into four different buildings now. And that's like, I'm the sergeant in our community relations unit. So this is coming directly to my teams, if you will. So while it's not being run out of the districts, they actually have a contact point where they can reach out. And, you know, there's all these different resources in the city, depending on what their area is and what they're experiencing. You know, if let's say the neighborhood watch is saying we've got a lot of needles in the playground or things like that, maybe we utilize Bear Clan Patrol or some of the other city resources to kind of help these different groups.
Yeah. And just so you know, there is the downtown watch that I've been trying to push, not the downtown watch, the downtown community partnership, which I'm trying to push a little bit more into Spence as much as I can. They too provide a lot of that service. So if there's not people, like if we need needle pickup, you know, like if it's, and just so everyone knows, if it's on the city, on the city sidewalk, the city's responsible for it. So you call 311, we get people down to clean it up. It could be multiple different partners that clean that up. And then if it's on somebody's property, you actually call StreetLinks, and StreetLinks picks them up. But the city can help you figure that out. But just to let you know, so we do have other kind of things going that are working with these neighborhood watch groups as well, that many of the different groups like Spence and people in Central Park, and I'm sure West Broadway, like they would have connections into you know, into kind of a more community organized, safety.
Okay, just one final thing, Andy. I remember from the last time this neighborhood watch used to be in existence that there were placards put up in different neighborhoods. This block is protected by a neighborhood watch kind of a signboard in different locations. Is that something that the police service or somebody is going to give out to anybody who's interested?
Yeah, we've definitely got decals and stuff for people who are involved in the neighborhood watch program for sure. There was a question with the signage is very expensive. And also we didn't really have statistics backing its efficiency, if you will, for lack of a better way of saying it. So while, you know, putting up a sign's a sign, right? Like walking to a store, it says, you know, theft will be prosecuted or whatever they have in their store. Those things don't really necessarily work as deterrents. It's more as knowing who's communicating with who. But I don't think there's plan for actual signs at this time.
Okay, if I remember correctly, the sign is that this area is protected by a neighborhood watch program. That kind of a sign board used to be there, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, I don't think at this time there's a plan to go back to that unless we can kind of figure out a way to see its efficiency, if you will, like to somehow track its effectiveness. Like, we want to make sure we're targeting resources in the right areas and kind of trying to make as big an impact as we can.
Okay, thank you.
I think there's another hand up, Jesse.
Hi, just to touch on Air Canada Park, I was curious about the timeline on that and if there's any like maybe immediate action we can take about the park too.
Sorry, can you repeat that again?
What was the timeline on the park and if there's any immediate action we can take? Just because I'm reading through a document here from APTN from my coworkers. It's just a very dangerous area at the moment, and I'm curious if there's anything that can immediately be done.
So what they are trying to work out, like, so the work is going to be starting late summer in, they said around August. We just met with the consultants that are going to be redoing the park. From the time being, I know APN was at the meeting, so I do know it's a huge concern and other people that were in that building. And so they're looking at, the business kind of looking at some pop-up events, if they can, but we're trying to look at the long-term plan. But right now I know it's an issue for the staff that's working in there, and they want, and I know APN wants to get people back to downtown, which we're trying to do. So I think that the biz is kind of trying to work that out with kind of some of their plans that they have around events and stuff, and with the downtown safety partnership.
Would we consider maybe closing the park early or maybe more cops in the area?
Well, I don't think they would consider closing the park early. That was, I mean, we did talk about that, but I don't think that we would do that. It won't be closed off until the construction is start. But as a police, I know that I think Andy's still on, I think he's still there. I think they know, you know, I think that there's many different organizations that are out there daily. What we're trying to do is revamp the park, not necessarily take everyone out of the park, but we don't want, like, there are some stuff happening in the park that isn't safe for people. And that's what we're trying to deal with, right? And that the people that are just there enjoying the park, we want everyone to feel welcome and safe. So there is a plan going forward, but really what I see, Jesse, is usually when we revamp something, things do clean up. Like when I saw the difference in Central Park and you know, it makes a difference. So that's what I'm hoping, right? And we hear people loud and clear about what's going on in the park, and we're just trying to do our best to manage it. And there's other pockets of that as well. But I don't know if Andy has anything to add from the police on the downtown stuff.
Hi, can you guys hear me?
Yeah, we're talking about Air Canada Park and stuff.
Yeah, sorry, I just had an emergency come under work. I'm unfortunately going to have to leave the meeting, okay? I apologize. It's kind of serious though, so I have to take this, okay?
Okay, thanks.
My apologies, you guys.
Yeah, no worries. So maybe I can try to get an update for next time, Jesse. I'll just write that down. Okay. Anyone else? Okay. All right. So can somebody just move a motion on my? Okay, Narinder, all in favor? Okay, and then opposed. Motion is carried. All right. So now we're into a verbal update for the coordinator.
Are we going to do the motion first?
Okay. Yeah, that's item two. Oh, right. Okay. Sorry. Okay. So now I remember last week, I'm not sure if everyone was there last meeting, but we have a request to put in some funding for the Human Rights Symposium on Poverty and Homelessness. And what was the amount? Sorry,
$1,000.
$1,000. Is somebody willing to put that motion forward? That's for Al Weave's symposium on letting homeless people come together and talk about shared experience and how we can deal with this issue. Narinder? Okay. Narinder moves. Any discussion? Okay. No discussion. All in support? Raise the hands. Okay. Any opposed? Okay. Motion is carried.
And essentially, we'll be one of the event sponsors for that now that we agreed to put this money in. And I'm sitting on the steering committee for the planning of it. And we have a meeting on Monday, so I'll let everyone know what the outcome of that meeting was.
And I think everyone's free to come to it, right?
Yeah, I was going to say, and once I have some more details about it, but if you want to mark it in your calendars, it's going to be at the Human Rights Museum on Monday, May the 28th, I think, or 29th, sorry. And it's free. There's no cost to go to it. And there'll be different speakers throughout the day, a couple of speakers panels on some specific topics. And that'll sort of hopefully get firmed up a little bit more after our meeting on Monday. But as sponsors, the committee members are welcome to attend if you want. But it's just, you kind of have to free yourself up for the day. I think we'll start around 9 o'clock and go till 3 or 4 in the afternoon. So it's a whole day event.
Okay. All right. So now we'll move on to verbal updates.
Okay. I've just still been working away on figuring some things out and getting stuff organized. One of the things that I was working on or have been kind of looking into, and I think I'm going to send everyone a link to, if you're familiar with these Who Do I Call cards, I'm sure all of you can see that from over here. but they're small cards that have different topics on them, and there's printed versions, and they're also available off of the web page for the Committee for Safety on the city's website. So they're a bit outdated and just need some refreshing, but it's also led me to think maybe there's some other topics that should be included. The cards I'm thinking are probably 4 or 5 years old now, and they are quite popular. I've got requests for hundreds of them from several organizations, so I don't want to leave it too long, but I also want to look at what's the best way to provide that information. And right now the cards have a lot of very small print information on them about a lot of organizations. I kind of wondered about creating a card that has maybe a QR code on it so that they're not having to try and read something in 4-point font, and they could, get access to the code, and it would take them to the page and thereby make it easier to keep all the information up to date and maybe a little more relevant. So I always say I never know who I'm dealing with in some of these groups. So maybe there's a mastermind amongst us that might have a good idea for these cards. But I'll send you out a little more information about it and some of my thoughts. And then if anyone has anything to add, I'd be happy to hear that before I move on with, doing either the right or the wrong thing to them. But I'll look forward to your input on that. There's also some other updates that need to be made to our webpage on the city site as well. So I'm going to work on that and get all that information updated. We're a little bit behind on doing an annual report for 2022, so I'm going to work on that as well. And if everyone thought, like, we seemed to spend most of last year working on our strategic plan, and that was, sort of took up a lot of our meeting time and the other things we're working on. So I thought maybe I would just do a report that highlights the things we've selected to work on and what our findings from that was and why we've chosen those things to focus on. And just try and get that out of the way so we're not getting too far behind with those reports. Also, Councillor Gilroy and I talked last week about the possibility of doing some, I don't know what this is like. We used to call it Indigenous awareness training when I worked for MPI. And so it was mandatory training that all staff people took to for them to have a better understanding of Indigenous issues in the country. And most workplaces do it now. We're, you know, here representing the city with the work that we do and the decisions we make. So it probably would be helpful for us to have some training in that area if, you know, it made our decision making easier, our conversations more wholesome in some areas. So I haven't heard back from them yet.
Okay.
the Indigenous Relations Division would be who that would be done through, but it's possible, you know, maybe some of you have taken that kind of training through your work or other organizations. So I would hopefully try and maybe do it in a way that it wouldn't, you know, take up too much of our time or too big of a block of time all at once. So I'll also try and be considerate of that. But does anyone have any thoughts about that, or, you know, anything that they could suggest that might make it easier to participate?
Hi, it's Barkley. Can you guys hear me okay?
Yes.
So we have in our organization, we have a team for Indigenous services, and something we do 2 to 4 times a year is a blanket exercise. If you folks are familiar with the concept,
yeah, that's good.
It's kind of a crash course into Indigenous awareness, and it's not for everybody, but it is it's about a 4-hour to 5-hour day with lunch. And it's immersive and quite experiential. That's why I say it may not be for everybody, but it's highly effective in immersing yourself into the Indigenous person's historical and immediate perspective. So I could see when we're doing one next, and we'd certainly be happy to invite friends like you to that event.
Okay.
Yeah,
well,
thank you very much. Okay, any other discussion on that? Okay, is there anything else?
The only other thing I wondered about, and for the newer members, you would remember this, but Kristen used to sometimes on a Friday usually send out information, like if there had been something in the media that week about something that we were, you know, working on or was a discussion, like today when we're talking about the housing issues, and, you know, there's been a lot of stuff in the media about that. Would you find it helpful if I were to resume that and, you know, I could just shoot out an email with some links to, you know, wherever the information came from, you know, then, or I could try and create maybe some kind of a place where the information could be stored if you wanted to go access it, and just might, you know, write a little background of, you know, some of the things people are talking about while we're talking about them in our meetings as well. So if you want, I can do it, but I also don't want to fill up your inboxes with more things that you might not want to read. So I could just give it a try. I could just, you know, send you some stuff, and I can, you know, you can tell me later if you found it helpful or not, and, you know, see if it's worth it. But I used to find it helpful, but I have a background in journalism, so I like reading news stories.
I'm not good at any of that. From some of the committee members.
Yeah.
So this is very informative.
Oh, okay. So that's
I think it's a great idea. And I like your idea of putting it in a central spot.
Yeah.
Because then you don't lose that.
Yeah.
I add something that I maybe should have added during my report, but I just thought about it. So the city is actually, like, it's something that maybe we should get a little team together. The city is actually right now doing their strat plan that I think is going to be coming through our system right away. And that's going to be our 4-year plan going into the next 4 years. And that's how the city's going to determine where they put money. So I think we should maybe get a little team together, whoever wants to work on that, a subcommittee, so that we can kind of, because that'll happen fast. like it'll be, I thought it was coming. I was just asking Jennifer. I think it's coming relatively soon. So if we can get a team together, just maybe looking at that once it gets published and just maybe voicing our thoughts to the council on what we would like to see in that strap plan in terms of safety and poverty reduction and you know, health and safety issues. So is everyone in agreement with that? Is there a willingness for some people to, okay, can somebody move a subcommittee then? Okay, Sarah, okay, all in favor? Looks like everyone said yes. So anyone interested in spending some time on the subcommittee, hands up. I just gave you work without telling you. Sorry. Okay, so yeah.
Sarah and Arindra.
Okay. Perfect. Okay. So yeah, I apologize for that. I just know it is something that's coming relatively fast, and I'd really love to have our input on that as it moves through the system. So
what's the deadline for?
It's not even out yet, the agendas, but I know it's coming. I think, do you know?
Yeah, I think the first community committee meeting is on Monday, so it's posted.
Oh, right, it is. But that's right, it is this Monday. Okay, so yeah, so sorry. Okay. There's a deadline. So it goes through each community committee up to EPC and then on to council. So we have like a month, like, well, within the month. So, you know, Well, I guess it might be. Is the agenda? The agenda has to be out already for City Center.
Yeah.
What we can do is we'll send out we'll send out the strat plan to everybody so you can get eyes on it and you'll kind of know what we're talking about and see if we can develop something that we want to send to council as a group. Okay. All right. Heads are shaking. We got a team. Good job. Okay, sorry about that.
Okay. So if you want, I can get the plan. I can send it to them and then set up a time to meet.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So, Kate, were you done your update or did I?
The only other thing I was going to say is I think we have all the meeting dates set for the rest of the year. So I'm going to send you an updated list with all the dates for the informal and formal meetings for the rest of 2023. And that was all I had to say.
Okay, perfect. Does somebody want to move the coordinator's report? Narinda moves. All in favor? Okay. None of us opposed, so motion's carried. All right, now we're moving on to, I think, verbal update from Crime Prevention Branch.
So Moxie didn't join us, yeah, right? Okay. Lorraine, he's not late.
Okay.
Yeah, so no report.
Okay, and now verbal update from Community Safety and Wellbeing.
I'll go ahead with my colleague right there. There's two kind of major files that we've been working on. We don't have a ton that we can share because we're waiting on some processes and announcements. But firstly, over a year ago, there was a council-directed revision to the LiveSafe policy from 2008. And so that's ongoing. And likely in the next few months, we'll kind of see that reflected in an agenda. But this committee might want to kind of add something to comment on for council. The second is the Building Safer Communities Fund. So this is a federal fund from Public Safety Canada that the City of Winnipeg will be allocating for various initiatives based in community in Winnipeg. So we're in active conversation with our counterparts there on announcing this grant and moving ahead with developing our proposal. So that's still in the works. And the other is working with the property planning and development in a public open house that they're organizing at the end of May on May 25th related to the downtown plan. Planning to have a safety or a community safety and well-being station at that public open house. So we're supporting them in kind of providing information, including those who to call cards and other resources that we have available for folks concerned with safety in the downtown and related to the planning process. So those are, that concludes my update. I'm not sure, Greg, if you wanted to add anything.
No, that's great. Maybe I can just add that, this committee has a really important role to play in our civic structure. And as our projects near council, we would be grateful, I think, as public servants, if the committee were to take a look at what we're doing, and provide comments in delegation. I think in particular, as we revise this LiveSafe policy and get to a point where council will be looking at it, I think you'll find when we're able to share it with you, our hope is that you'll find that a lot of the principles that are in that new version of this policy will reflect a lot of the hard work and conversations that have happened at this table over the last few years. And I think we're very much in alignment with your strategic plan, the strategic plan of this group. And so, yeah, it's really valuable for us as we put forward new projects and policies around safety and well-being, that this group is informed and takes a hand in helping make sure that council understands that Winnipeggers are in favor of or potentially opposed to the work that we're doing. So yeah, we'll continue to inform you as we get closer to having something we can share publicly, but just wanted to reinforce and really want to say too that I think it is valuable. Tracy, you talked about sending out some information on Fridays, and it would be great for all of us. I think I would really value that as well, having good information that we can talk about as a committee regularly, specific to the topics that are being brought up here at this table, so that we can inform council. And that's a really important and valuable role that you play as a citizens advisory committee. So just want to reinforce that. And otherwise, thanks. Nice to see everybody.
You too. Thanks. And let us maybe give us just a little reminder. Like, usually I see that stuff, but it's always good to just remind me and send that, and we'll try to, so that everybody gets a copy of what's being proposed.
Okay. Well, and I was going to say, at our last meeting, Greg and Andrea asked that if anyone was interested to sit on the, is it the steering committee? It's the, so the Building Safer Communities Fund, if you'll remember, part of the process will be a revision or a review committee for the proposals that come from community and from the public service. So the invitation is still open, in part because we're waiting for the announcement to happen. And so if anybody is interested in taking on that role as a representative of this committee, certainly welcome your participation.
Quick question, if I may, what's the time commitment to that committee?
It'll likely be one meeting of, I would assume, about an hour and a half to 2 hours, plus the time to review the proposals. And because we don't know how many will be coming our way, I can't say exactly. I would assume it might be, between 6 and 8 hours of time.
Over a week, a month?
It'll likely be in about 3 weeks, and that'll be over about a week and a half, the time commitment.
Okay. Thank you.
Great. All right. Does somebody want to move the report? Sarah? Okay. All in favor? Okay, none was opposed. Motion's carried. Now we do have some time. Does anybody want to bring up any discussion? We have time. Anything going on in your neck of the woods that you want to share with the group? No? Are there everyone's going to stay warm? Oh, Sarah does. Okay.
I just wanted to touch on, I live on one of the streets that has the reduced speed limit of 30 kilometers an hour. And not that long ago, I guess we got a notice that was getting extended. And I just wanted to share how much really glowing positive feedback the neighborhood has had about that. All the families on my street feel so confident letting their kids out to play and letting them out unsupervised to run across the street to the community center. And people are using it so much more for biking and walking, and I've seen so many more seniors. It's been really lovely. So I just wanted to share that as far as just something that has happened that has been really positive in my community anyway.
And now, so, you know, like Sarah, that's something like if we want to talk about that as a committee, that's another thing that you can come to council when that comes forward, like they're doing this pilot, right?
Yeah.
Forward. I've been somebody that's been in favor of it, so I'm going to be honest with you all. I've been a proponent of the reduced speeds, but that is something that you could come to council and definitely talk about. And if we agree on it as a committee, we could decide that this is a policy stand we want to take, and we can go there on behalf of this committee. Is there? But maybe we'll put that on the discussion for next time.
When is the pilot? Like, do you
know? No, I'd have to find that all out. It's in through Public Works. I'd have to ask some questions. I can't remember. But we'll look into that, and then maybe we can put that as a talking item on the agenda. And like everyone, this isn't that everyone can feel free to talk how you feel about things. This is, you know, this is a safe space too. So you don't have to agree with everything that's coming from everybody, but I think it's a safe space. But it is something that we do have those slow down signs. It's something that we as a group have in the past, the old committee has really taken on and championed, just because, you know, we do want to make sure we have safe streets. And I know that in especially older neighborhoods, we really feel the impact of the traffic and stuff. So we'll put it on for discussion. Is there any other items? Oh, you're muted, Barclay.
Yes, please.
Oh, okay. Who was first? Put up your hand.
Abby was.
Go ahead.
Okay, thank you. So sometime last year, I know we're discussing about having an event which would include the community and some other organizations to more like educate the populace about what we do and, you know, why we are here. I just wanted to know if that's still a priority for us.
I love that idea.
Yeah. And further to my discussion about the Who Do I Call cards, refreshing those cards and providing that information offers the opportunity to do, you know, maybe sort of a public relations campaign to, you know, get people in the know again that those cards are available, could do something.
A launch, a public launch, and have different organizations participate.
Yeah. And also that, you know, we could start promoting them in other city locations, community centers. There are used in the libraries, but it would be a good chance to put the committee out there again, as you know, that this is one thing we do, but also highlight other things that we work on, and you know, like making it into a little more than just saying we've got fresh cards. We could promote ourselves a little more, I think, in that way, and talk about some things. And there's also, you know, participating in, you know, even though we're not the planners of the homelessness symposium, participating in that and being a sponsor to that, that's going to get our name attached to that event. And, you know, hopefully, since it is one of the prongs of our strategic plan, you know, if there's some information that's gained from that day or something that comes about that, you know, we would be the right people to champion that in the right way. You know, that's a chance for us to have more of a voice in that respect as well. So yeah, there's, you know, I think lots of things we can
really good. That's a very good idea, though. Very good idea. Was there somebody else?
Mine is more of a policy question, if you don't mind me asking. So if you could refresh my memory on what the update was on the initiative for support / security on public transit.
So there is, we don't know what that's going to look like yet. There is some funding putting into it. I think there's dialogue on what it's going to look like. So there's two kind of two trains of thoughts. There is a group, I forget, they're called Connective. What are they called? The Community Connective in the libraries. Do you remember what they're called, Greg? I don't know.
Community safety posts?
Yes, the community, there's kind of that community safety post with what we had in the library that looked at, you know, they come in and they have training, and there are actually a lot of people that have lived experience as well. So they have training and on how to kind of be pleasant, greet, but also make sure that, you know, they're supporting the needs of the people that are right there. And then there's also looking at kind of like what other cities do. They're called, I hate the word transit police, but they're just, you know, added people on the buses that just kind of oversee the bus and what's going on for the bus driver that can't see everything that's going on. And if there is a need, would be able to call for supports. So that's what they're looking at right now. Funding is in place, but I think that there's debates on what it's going to look like. Yeah, but I can kind of keep you, if you remind me, I'll keep you updated once we know a little bit more. Because that's enough.
I'm sorry, Councillor, please proceed.
Yeah, you got thoughts on that, if that's something you want to dive into more, we definitely can.
That's okay. It sounds like there's action occurring on that. And finally, if someone could just educate me again on this, whose purview is it does transit have a position on people living in transit shelters, or does the city have a position on that?
So no, there's been no position on that. Okay, so it's kind of a case by case basis. They do try not to encourage it. It has, you know, when we did try to remove people out of transit shelters, there was kind of an outcry from the public. I think there is, the city is looking at, though, a way we can combine some of the, like, I they're not security, I don't know what we're going to call them, but having those kind of same elements that maybe some of the spots. I personally really feel that we should keep the bus shelters open for the public. I'm having too many issues within my ward for my seniors and people with disabilities. One person I was actually going to have come and present to somebody with a disability, and he was going to talk about what it's like to try to go in. He has a CNI dog. And what it's like to try to go into the bus shelter and doesn't know who's in there and what's coming upon them. So I think there is a bigger dive that they want to take, but there has been no position at this time. I, as a counselor, think that we need to kind of work a little bit more collaboratively with the Main Street Project and how we're going to deal with this. But this also could be a discussion that we have with the province, because Like, I'll be honest with you, I'm very frustrated. I really feel that a lot of this stuff has been left to the province, left to the city, that the province is really responsible for, right? So it becomes a policing matter. If we had proper supports where people live, proper supports in the community organizations that serve these people, most vulnerable people, we would not be seeing the issues that we have if we had housing. So I'm frustrated. But having said that, you asked me if there's a response. There isn't. It's really on a case-by-case basis, how long it's been going on, up to kind of the area counselor to manage. And that's how they've been dealing with it at this time.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah. Okay. Well, seeing no other questions, I'm glad that we did have some time to chat. If you guys do have issues that you want to raise and bring up, like, please feel free to contact me or Tracy, because these are really good discussions and we can make sure that we kind of spend some time on it. This is how we're going to get stuff done at the city. And you know what? I don't know everything that's going out there. That's why you guys are here, you know, helping me too, because you're going to be able to tell me what's going on in other parts of the city or within your workspaces that we could be helping to kind of coordinate and collaborate on making the city safer. So let us know. So other than that, does somebody want to? Oh, great. Sorry.
That's okay. No, I was just going to add the same thing that, I mean, Andre and I are both here now as new staff over the past year. It's a new resource that we offer the citizens of Winnipeg. So if you do have questions that you'd like answers for, we're also a resource that you're welcome to tap into. We work a lot. So we're around and available. And if you have questions, please do contact us as well. Thank you.
Yeah, no, that's really great. Thank you both for that. And thank you both for what you're bringing to the table. It's been really great to kind of get the ear of community services. You guys do so much great work. And really, it is the heart of what we're talking about in terms of prevention and stuff. So thank you both for being really good allies for us too in our work. So, well, thanks everybody. Can I have somebody move to adjourn? Render. Okay, all in favor? Motion's carried. Thanks, everybody.